Thank you, Rashmeet, for such a generous introduction for all of us. As you are aware, the topic for today's discussion is navigating the glass ceiling. As some of you may be aware, it's a metaphor that is used for invisible barrier that some people experience to get to senior leadership roles. People look at the opportunities right in front of them and are still unable to attain it in spite of their best suitability and best effort. A joint research by Lenin and McKinsey tells us that women are 18% less likely to be promoted compared to their male counterparts. It's a term that goes beyond gender and diversity, ethnicity, though. It's a term that affects people from all walks of life for a range of reasons. It has a negative impact on organizations, cultures, entrepreneur ventures, everything. And on the other hand, diversity leads to innovation, growth, and higher revenue. So let's see what our business leaders have to say about this as we talk about navigating the glass ceiling and we hear some of their real life stories as they've made their way up the ladder. So Poonam, I wanted to start with you. You started World Forum about 12 years back with the aim to promote women in leadership. And I'm sure this has come with its challenges. I wanted to understand some of the challenges that you have faced as you've navigated the ceiling. How did you resolve those challenges?
Hello, thank you all for joining us here. Most excellent to have this conversation. You know, I'm one of those people who thinks I'm a pioneer because I try to do things which I think have got meaning and are really high impact, which are going to change our lovely planet to be better. So when I started the Will Forum 12 years ago, everybody, you know, I'm an economist and, you know, I'm the regional director of the Conference Board of New York in India, and everybody's saying to me, so what are you doing? What is this you've started? There is absolutely no appetite for women in leadership 12 years ago. So the first so-called glass ceiling is that where is the appetite and how to create it? You have to create an appetite for what you think is right. It's extremely important to do that. So moving on from there, as I kept going through and trying to explain to people and getting the buy-in, what they didn't understand is that I'm an economist. And the first thing I kept telling everybody is that it's not about women. It's about women in leadership. Can we just get the words right? And after that, I have to say, and I think Rachel mentioned the buoyancy in India. We are 500 million women. That's 8% of the world population. Mark my words, Indian women are 8% of the world population. Who is going to unlock this value? You have to unlock this value. Where is the appetite to unlock this value? So the next glass ceiling I had to deal with is that there is no data. There's absolutely no data on women. And so first thing I had to do is to get out with the data. The third glass ceiling that I saw, and I don't call this glass ceiling because I would like everybody to change their words if possible. Can we call it gender discrimination? Can we call it lack of equal opportunity? Can we call it no level playing field? Because when you say glass ceiling, it could mean just about everything. So the next thing I had to deal with was the complete lack of women in top positions who were willing to listen to me. So I had this whole host of men who simply thought that leadership is a domain and an experience and a status symbol which doesn't belong to women. That is why today, after 12 years, Urvi, I have written a book on leadership by proxy. By proxy, because half the population thinks that they know everything about leadership. They never ask us, do you know anything? That glass ceiling is a very important glass ceiling you gotta crack. That leadership does not belong to anybody. Leadership belongs to everybody. Everybody is a leader. Whoever unleashes themselves becomes a leader. Whoever gets up and says, I will unlock my value, becomes a leader. It's no problem. But the women have a unique leadership style, and it has to be embedded in the workplace. Because, not because it's a good thing to do, because it will increase productivity, wealth creation, innovation, put you on the competitive edge. These are the kind of so-called glass ceilings I'm talking about, not the usual stuff that you see. It's about the language, it's about the positioning, it's about the vision, it's about how you see yourself, it's about the perception. We just have to work on that equation.
Thanks, Poonam, that was fantastic. Taking the conversation forward, Praveen, I wanted to ask you, BlackRock has been a big proponent of increasing the number of women in the boards of the organization. Based on your personal experience, do you want to highlight some instances where you have supported and helped experienced women break the glass ceiling and get to senior leadership roles?
Thank you, Ree. Very glad to be here. I don't know if I'm qualified to be on this stage, but I'll take the opportunity. Thank you. Listen, I have a generic mindset approach to the topic and two or three specific things that I want to come back to, to your question. But I want to first frame the conversation, right? Rachel touched upon it, Ms. Berwer touched upon it. In my mind, it's not about men versus women. It's not just a feminist issue. It's a social issue about equality. I just want to frame that, right? That being said, we do have hundreds of years of biases, which means we have to be deliberate about equality. So my generic approach is that. I try and be deliberate about recognizing men and women. I try and be deliberate about empowering, through delegation, women and men. That means, at least in my self-assessment, you should ask my team what they think, but at least in my self-assessment, I do more of recognition and delegation, and that already makes you a better leader. The whole notion of when you genuinely help someone, it actually helps yourself. So that's a very, very powerful point. On the specific things, the number one thing in my experience is sponsorship. Both the formal program type, but also other ways. And being an economist on the stage, if you need another reason for men in the room or women in the room, I think the whole notion of the helping helps the helper is equally applicable on sponsorship as well. It helps you develop the leader who grows leader muscle in a way that you cannot do otherwise. It's incredible. And I've personally been very, very fortunate to be benefiting from that. The second thing I want to say is what I call why not analysis. I think this is important. At our firm, the whole promotion process was designed to test the strength and fairness of all the nominated cases, as you would imagine, right? This is what I would call the why analysis, as in the whole focus was to find reasons why we should or should not promote someone. And I fundamentally believed a large part of the bias was actually off the list in terms of women not even considered. So we started this whole thing, which is the line-by-line review, and challenging like what we ended up calling the why not analysis. And that helped us uncover a lot of biases and deal with some of them. I do think we have a long journey to go. And the last thing I'll say before I pause is again, Rachel touched upon that. I try and amplify female voice in meetings. There's a magic in the meeting behaviors, the microaggressions that she talked about. You could do micro behaviors thing to that. At the appropriate moment, if you can amplify the female voice, again, with the notion of equality of participation, equality of consideration, that makes a big difference. So the mindset thing, the sponsorship, the why not, and the voice amplification.
Very insightful, Praveen. Thank you. Sukirti. Oh, we've had the opportunity to work together on a number of occasions, and I know you have this never quit attitude, and I love it. I wanted to ask, based on your experience, do you think women pay too much attention to their inner critique that tells them that they don't have it, what it takes to be at the top? And have you ever experienced this kind of feeling and, couple this with the reluctance to navigate organizational politics? We're almost doing ourselves a disservice. Have you ever experienced this in your professional or personal life, and how did you come out of it?
Wow. Well, first of all, welcome to all the lovely ladies. So I think for me, I was very, very fortunate. Maybe because when I started...
What about us men?
Oh, the lovely men out there too. Sorry. Great that you're all here. But you know, when I started my career, it was fantastic that we saw a lot of role models emerging. We had Indra Nooyi, we had Carly Fiorina. And I was very, very fortunate when I joined Nokia. We had Sari Baldoff. And I was working at Nokia, and I was working at Nokia Networks, a very technology-intensive firm. And there was this fearless leader. And we heard all these stories about her, how she went to China, and she changed the fortunes of Nokia Network, how she kind of took over, and she became the senior VP. So I think when I saw her, and I saw that she was able to do it, we saw these role models out there, and we saw that they were actually able to navigate the systems. I think I said, you know what? I'm not wearing glass slippers. I need to wear heels with spikes. And those spikes, you need to actually say, I will crash any glass ceiling. Because when you see other women that are doing it, you see other women in close proximity that are doing it, you also get the ability to actually speak to them, learn from them, understand from them what their challenges were and how they went about it. I must also say I was very fortunate because I was working with Nokia. And if Nokia people know, it's a Finnish company. It's a very progressive company. And Finland is very, very progressive in terms of the women, the male ratio. So I do think I had some benefits to my side. But when you talk about politics, and this is that million-dollar question, we all hate it. And this is when I want to come back to that book, The Subtle Art of Not Giving, I can't say the word, but when he says it, when you're working in an environment, you need to understand the environment. And you know what? You need to understand that there will be some amount of politicking. And growing up the career ladder, it's not very easy for us to say, yes, there's politics, but I'm going to stay away from it, but I still expect to rise. When you look at an environment, and I'm saying I came from an environment which was extremely sensitive, there was still politics there. I could very easily say, nahi bhaiya, main nahi karti. But no, I have to understand that if I want to grow, and I am going to say, I want to play the game. I want to play the game at the same level. The men are playing the game. I need to do some amount of politicking. And I think I've first decided that that word is not negative. Yeah? So the first thing is that connotation of the word. So we put the connotation on the word that when we are self-promoting, when we are going out there, when we're building our own prophecy or telling about ourselves, or we are advocating for ourselves, somehow we are politicking. So I took that word and I said, maybe, can I look at it as a more positive word? And I am doing what all the other guys are doing. And yes, I was probably 2 out of 10 women, and maybe being in the tech world, I was surrounded by men the whole time. So when I saw their attitude, I just said, oh, you know what, it's normal. I'm going to do the same thing. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does, beautifully, thanks. Dinkar, today's Saint Gobain has more than 6,500 employees on board, and you've been with the organization for quite some time. I wanted to ask you, what according to you are some of the organizational and environmental challenges that hinder women's representation in leadership roles, and what do you think women can do differently to enhance their representation?
Thank you. Once again, like everyone else, I'm very privileged to be here and quite humbled to be part of the DAS. I come from a brick and mortar industry, not from technology, a company that makes automotive glass, shop floor, brick, old world, lots of engineers and technicians and operators, combination of blue collar and white collar. So my world is a very different world. And it has changed. 30 years back, you could hardly count the number of women in the shop floor. There was actually no one. And in the offices, they were mostly in secretarial and support functions. That has changed. A lot more mechanical engineers coming out of graduate schools. And they have joined companies like ours. And we do have an environment that actively encourages women to seek out leadership roles and do just about every shop floor job that a male engineer can do. Also lucky to be part of Saint-Gobain, it's a European company. Europe is way ahead of us on gender diversity. Just to give some numbers, Saint-Gobain in Europe has 45% women in the workforce, 55% in Scandinavia, and we are a pathetic 7%. So that's a long catching up to do. And the good thing is that there is a lot of corporate pressure to improve diversity. And while we talk of diversity as the first stepping stone, which is a good number to achieve, what's even more important is not just the numbers in the workforce, because you can have numbers at any level, but it's actually having numbers at the leadership level. And that's something where we really aren't anywhere where we should be. It's a long haul. I will not pretend that there is light at the end of the tunnel. There really isn't. One thing, just to answer the question very directly, is The biggest challenge women have is the dual roles that nature imposes on them. And by that I specifically talk of the break that many of them are forced to take because of childbearing. Companies have very good policies to facilitate women taking a break for bearing a child, but not too many have very good policies of how to get them back to work in a way that they don't lose out on, which is an area where we have actually spent a lot of time, because you know, when someone takes 6 months off or 8 months off, sometimes a little more than that, the business environment changes. And when the business environment changes, women getting back, you know, on paper you can protect you know, their seniority or whatever else we call, but really in terms of getting them back to the job that they used to do or the job that they should have moved into had they not had that break is a big challenge. And this is an area where we are trying to spend some time. How do we get women back into the workforce after the forced break that they have to endure in a way that they don't feel the loss, at the same time the organization also gives them that recognition that, you know, we still value you and you're still an important part of the team.
Great, Dinkar. I think a very valid point. We have a lot of catching up to do on this front, and we have to ensure that, A, we have more women in the workforce, and we are getting our women back to workforce who have taken break for valid reasons. So going on to our next question, Poonam. You had a range of experiences on your profile, from being a lecturer at Delhi University to being the CEO and founder at World Forum. You know, some situations where you had the support of other women and community who helped you shatter the glass ceiling.
Let me first just comment, because this is a panel discussion, and I think that what comes to us, we also must respond to that. I do want to say that it is time to stop making excuses for not having women in leadership roles. Any excuse will do? No, it won't. If we keep on, you know, you can do anything in business, whether it is making profits or getting past the geopolitics or getting past the disruption in business, then why are there so many excuses for getting women on boards or women in top leadership positions? So the first glass ceiling that I want to add to my many glass ceilings is, can we stop making excuses? Now, the other excuse that we come across is called meritocracy. Can we redefine meritocracy? This glass ceiling of meritocracy is a problem. We have to redefine meritocracy. It cannot be, to my logical mind, that if you have meritocracy in the workplace, there are no women on top. So my logical mind will say that the women are defunct, the women are useless, the women are disabled. No, 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 no. The ecosystem must be unequal. That's the logic I will go to. These are the kind of glass, large glass ceilings I want people to crack. Listen to the equation and get the equation right. It's not about meritocracy. It's about equal opportunity for women. Get the meritocracy on top of equal opportunity. Then I get it. Till then, redefine the glass ceiling. So if you can hear me talk, then you will know, from being a lecturer to being a CEO to being an independent director on boards for the last 8 years, I'm saying the same thing. Can you please open your eyes? Can you please change your eyes? What are eyes? The perspective with which you see things. Can you please change your perspective? That is another glass ceiling you have to crack. Corporate India, Fortune 500, please change the lenses with which you're looking at women. You can't have the same lens you used 100 years ago, 20 years ago, 10 years ago, and say women are taking a break. Listen to my data. Only 12% of women on an average leave the workforce for the break. I want to know what happened to the other 88%. How come the whole agenda is being hijacked for women who leave the workforce? I don't get it. There are 88% women sitting there. It's a huge body. Why is the conversation not centered around equal opportunity for them? Now you understand what I mean. From being a lecturer to a CEO, I will say the same thing. If I was a lecturer in Delhi University and, you know, I'm teaching BCom honors at my young age of 22, 23, all these guys in my class think that she doesn't know how to teach. Forget about economics, she just doesn't know how to teach. Okay, okay, hang in there. Don't move. Let them do what they want. I will be the last person standing in the room, even if there is only one student left. No problem. It's called unlock your value, power of self. Understand your glass ceiling and hang in there. Don't change your glass ceiling for somebody else. Okay, nobody come to my class. You're the one who's not going to pass the exam. Got nothing to do with me. I'm going to get my salary anyway.
Great, Budham. Yeah, we indeed need to start wearing our lenses differently to view the situation from a different view. Praveen, the next one is for you. And I wanted to ask this question to you because I feel you're going to bring a lot of global perspective here from BlackRock. So a potential obstacle facing this new wave of women is the concept of glass cliff. And this happens when women take leadership roles of organizations that are going through any kind of trouble, crisis, or failures. And this could be the exact situation that Robin Denholm, who's the newly founded female chairman of Tesla, is facing. And she had to assume the role because Tesla was going through a securities fraud investigation. So I wanted to understand, what do you think about this? Is it an opportunity in disguise, and women should take up these kind of roles for troubled firms? Or do you think it's a sure shot recipe for disaster to fall off the cliff?
Wow, awesome question. I've been a financial risk professional for many years, so I'll start there. And from that experience, there are two things I want to bring into discussion. One, at least in my experience, the worst risk you can take is the one you do not understand. And the second thing I would say is if you do not take risk, the smart way of around the risk is manage risk, not eliminate it. If you do not take the risk, you get the risk-free return, which in this historic era of low interest rates is pretty close to zero, even negative in a lot of places. So my bias a little bit would be to say yes, go for the challenge, assuming certain criteria is met. What do I mean by that certain criteria? The right set of stakeholders have to be honest about the situation. You can't let it be a tick in the box. We gave you the opportunity, you failed at it. The right set of stakeholders have to be honest about the situation. And they have to be willing to give you the support that is invariably needed in such situations. And the third thing, I'll pause that, and the set of criteria in there, is the reason for picking you, men or women, has to be because you seem to have the qualities that are needed for the turnaround situation we're talking about. So as long as those conditions are met, I would say go for it. Ultimately, though, I do think it's like any other career decision. I wouldn't have too much of a bias for or against these specific type of opportunities. I would rather look at a specific situation and see if it has the, as the Japanese would say, the ikigai combination of, like, what do you really want to progress in your career? What does the job really need you to do? And what do you bring to that job? And if that combination is there, go for it. And if it's not, I don't know why you would go for it.
Interesting. Very good to know that. I want to understand your take on this, Sukirti.
So I also feel the same way. No pain, no gain. You have to take a lot of risks. And when any opportunity is presented to you, you need to assess that opportunity and you need to assess your skill against that opportunity. If you feel that you're capable of handling it, you know, sometimes life is not a pretty picture. You will not be rising up when, you know, everything is going great. Usually, you do get these opportunities in positions when times are challenged. So usually you get the opportunity for growth also, even within a corporation when times are challenged. I've seen that for myself, either when a new business was being started, a new business needed to be turned around, but you need to look at it, and I understand what you have said. Do you understand what you're getting into, man or woman, and do you feel that you have the skill set, the energy and the passion that you feel that you would be able to be successful in that? So I don't feel it's a woman or a man thing. I just think that yes, if you fail as a woman, sometimes you are blamed because you are a woman.
Valid point. Thanks, Sukirti. This one is for you, Dinkar. They say mentorship can open doors for women in the workplace. Do you believe women are over-mentored and under-sponsored? Is there any reality to it?
Straight up answer, I think so, yes. And I'll just take a minute on why I feel that way. You know, mentorship is a good thing. It ensures there is a certain ease at workplace. There's someone that you can lean on for some kinds of distress that you might have or some kind of uneasiness that you might face, and also the comfort of knowing that you have somebody in the organization who's been there longer than you to reach out to for whatever might be the difficulties you might face. But really, in my mind, sponsorship is a lot more relevant because it ensures tangible outcomes. Sponsorship gets linked to goals. When you, by, you know, even in the semantic sense, when you call yourself a sponsor, you're actually committing a certain outcome. You know, you're possibly talking of a role, a title, specific responsibilities, deliverables, and therefore, what, you know, it was a popular American expression, skin in the game, I would think, is much, much higher when somebody moves the needle beyond mentorship, which is good, but certainly sponsorship is far, far more empowering, far, far more, the outcomes are much more tangible and far more beneficiary, both to the women and, of course, to the organization at large. I would think so, yes.
Okay. Great. So on our concluding note, I want to ask each one of our panelists our final question. What, according to you, are the two most important changes needed to help women navigate the glass ceiling? And let's start with you, Poonam.
The first thing is that you have to drop the word glass ceiling out of your head. There is no such thing. Not because it doesn't exist, but because if you don't define the problem properly, you won't be able to fix it. What is the glass ceiling? Please say it. Are you discriminated? There is no equal opportunity. There is no level playing field. There is a gender bias. There is no gender promotion. What is it that you want? Please define it. And only then you will be able to get past the so-called glass ceiling. I've written a book of 85,000 words and I've not used the glass ceiling anywhere, right? Or diversity or inclusion, because it's about women in leadership. What was the second?
The two most important changes needed.
The second thing is that you have to always remember, and that is why I like Lean In, the Lean In community and the Lean In circle. You know, for me, it's about Will Meet Up. I call it Will Meet Up. What you need to remember is, what do you have to lean into? You see how I'm trying to bring clarity to words. You want to lean into what? First, lean into yourself. Single most important thing, can you please lean into yourself? Can you please unlock your own value? Nobody can do it for you. You know, I'm a fitness person. I have to do the 10 push-ups myself. If somebody else does it, I'm not going to get the benefit. Same thing. Unlock your own value. Get your own power of self. Once you have leaned into yourself, you know the Indian thing, aham brahm, I'm the universe, I'm the cosmos, everybody revolve around me. It's not arrogant, it's a good appreciation of self, which is very important. Then you get others to lean into your divine spirit. You can't do lean in until you know that you have leaned into yourself. So I actually don't like networking, I want power networking. Not because power to get to the top. First, release your power. Then go network your power with other people. Multiply the power. Do it.
Great, great advice there. You know. What's your take on this, Dinkar?
Two important things. I'll say it's in two words. One is ambition. Women have to be ambitious with the belief that they can be as good at whatever goal they might set for themselves in exactly the same way anyone else does. And the second thing is to desire and the passion to be a role model. Because role model, being a role model has multiple benefits. Of course, it's in the tangible part is what you yourself achieve, but even more so, you set an example for 100 more people to learn from you, learn from your success and emulate it. So I would say these two things would be very important.
Yeah, I think fabulous two words there. Sukirti, what are your thoughts?
I think first, learn to ask for it. I think most of the jobs and the senior leadership positions that I went for them. I either applied for them, I challenged myself, they were not given to me. So start asking for it, start telling people, start showing off your skills and saying, yes, I am ready, I want the next big challenge. The second thing is the concept of fairness and equity, which I think has to come into a lot of organizations. So you do feel that if you're putting in your 100%, the organization is also giving back the same way.
Great, I think I so agree with her that you get in life what you have the guts to ask for. You know, that's so true. Your take on this, Praveen.
That's awesome, Maria. I think I'll make it about us. you know, me and our women colleagues. So I'll say two things. I'll start with, let's say, myself. I think the number one thing that needs to change is the clarity and the loudness of the tone at the top. Senior leaders have to stick their neck out and make it very clear where they stand on the issue. One very specific thing that I'm trying to do in the whole same spirit is move towards pay for the role, not on who is in the role. It doesn't have to be in the anti-meritocratic way of if everyone is paid the same, where is the incentive to perform? I do think you can decouple the base pay from performance incentives. It doesn't have to be too influenced by someone's comp history from the past. It doesn't have to be case by case. It has to be who's like actually not about who's in the role, but pay for the role. So for example, that, and then taking your team along. Remember, policies don't make change, people do. So as senior leaders, we need to take our people along. It's a little bit of a carrot and stick, but a lot more carrot, I hope. So number one thing is the tone from the top. The number two thing, which is I say you, I really mean women, is I want to touch upon something which I think is very deep, and where women have to own their part of the solution. I think it goes back to our inner struggles, the ways of thinking, and the emotional repercussions of that. A little bit of context. You know, as much as our cultural history is, you know, like Ms. Barwar touched upon, tatvamasi or aham brahmasmi or whatever, it's also true that the traditional upbringing in this part of the world, I'll bleed Indian, by the way, but this is one part of being Indian that I'm not proud of. Our traditional upbringing means that our collective conscious and racial touched upon men and women. We've absorbed cultural values over hundreds of years where men are for, you know, power and money, and women are for, you know, family and children. We've moved the dial on that thinking, but in this day and age of coronavirus, maybe I'm going to use the virus syndrome as an example, that same virus is trying to survive itself by turning itself, transforming itself into ambivalence. Women get confused about whether they really want their career to progress fast, the so-called implications of that, the so-called, do I want a different future? I think you have to solve that ambition, solve that ambivalence. Maybe I would say, I want you to want it. Like, turn that ambivalence into ambition. It doesn't have to be in the my needs are above everything else selfish way. You might as well link it to the purpose movement going on in the corporations right now, you know, where you're driven by a sense of purpose, by, you know, by actions aligned to your values, where it's not about just your selfish agenda. It's about, you know, progressing the common good. So the tone at the top, and I want you to want it.
Great, Praveen. That was a very valuable insight. We're going to be opening the house for questions now. So. Sure, go for it.
Women, and we need to stop making excuses for not having women in the leadership position. It's also about the narrative that we are shaping, the discourse that we are shaping by having our conversations. For example, in the last discussion, there was a point where they said that, you know, I have a 50-50 partnership at home. The kind of household responsibilities are divided between husband and wives. It's lucky. I'm fortunate to have a you know, supportive partner or supportive parents or supportive in-laws. No, we are normalizing the gendered roles for men and women in a way that we are kind of moving away from that. And ideally, having a supportive partner should be the normal, right? So it is very important to you know, pay attention to the language that we are using and shaping the discourse. That is very, very important. And that got reflected in a lot of points that some of the speakers mentioned. So yeah, just a short comment. Thank you.
Great, thanks.
Yeah.
A recent law, which is on the childcare leave, for example, given by the government, for 2 years, only for women. What if we gave it to both the partners and let them decide who wants to take a leave for how long? why are all the laws so gender biased? And why are we still not doing anything about it? Are there no people at the top who can help us change these laws? Looked at from, even the thumb rule, which they say in England, the stick should have been thinner than the thumb when you could hit the woman and it was okay. So why are we not changing those? Is anybody around taking care of that?
So here's the thing, Surabhi, right? Surabhi? She's been following me on LinkedIn. The thing is that, you know, when you talk about laws, I will give another example to you. On April 1, 2020, there will be more than 1,000 companies that are going to be penalized by SEBI for not having a woman on the board. Okay, they'll take the penalty, but they won't put a woman on the board. I'm trying to tell you wherein lies the glass ceiling. It's not about the laws. The laws are there. They're still not. Even page 100 of my book has named all the 100 companies that don't. So it's not a question of having women here or a law there. It's a question of changing the mindset to follow the law. That's the glass ceiling. Can we change the mindset to follow the law? It's not the law. The law is doing its job.
I have introduced myself in the last session, but I'll do it again. My name is Sunita Thawani. I'm a lawyer by profession. And my question is to Dinkar. You talked about, women returning to work.
Yeah.
I had a 12 years of break in my career.
Right.
Complete break. And then a chance opportunity with Mr. Rusi Modi got me a job in Tata Steel. 25 years later, I retired as chief legal of one of the Tata companies. So my comment on that is that probably senior leaders like you should engage when you are assessing the potential of these women who want to return and not let them go through the normal HR channel. Because they will never look at those CVs. It is the potential which is required to be judged because they are all educated, they have all had experience, but they have had a break because of, and I will say we have been talking about glass ceiling, it's more of sticky floors which these mindsets create. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I didn't hear a question, so I thought that was an insightful comment and I take the point, yeah.
Hi, this is Sonu, and I have been part of Lean In for the last 5 years. I have a question. I think the question this lady just raised, Surabhi, want to add on to it. Most of this leaning in has been an advice which has been given to women saying, we are leaning in for each other, but the industry has not been leaning in for men. I'm going back to the same question. All of these policies have started hitting us back because I believe it's a conspiracy by men to give all of this to women so that they sit at home. So I would rather recommend give 6 months leave to men. They can take care of the kids. The minute we stop discriminating on the policies and the law, mindset would change. So my question would be for Sukirti. And Sukirti, would you have to take a leave and did you really have to struggle with the partner? How did you manage to do that at home and at work?
So first of all, thank you. That's a very relevant point because I think a lot of the laws, like especially I go back to Finland or the US, they're becoming more fair. But yes, I do have a very, very supportive partner. So we do come back to that. But when I had children, they were much later in life. And I was very lucky that I had planned for them and I had planned my support system very well. So I did not take so much time off and I went back to work quite quickly. But I think that is not possible for a lot of the women that have worked for me. And I realized that situation in which you're coming and you're becoming a new mother, and the transition that is happening not only within your family sphere, a lot of the men are not as supportive to the women, and they were not able to return back after the 6 months. And I found this for a lot of women that came, worked for me. They wanted to come back. They were very sure when they were taking the leaves that they would be back. They assured me, I will be back. But after 6 months, trying to manage, trying to juggle, even coming back and maybe working for a couple of months, they said, you know what, guess what, ma'am? It's just not doable because my family circumstance is not allowing it.
Can I add a little bit of a shade, please?
Please.
Thank you. I mean, I see there's a little bit of a sense in the room, discussion, a couple of previous questions around, you know, is the equality really equal when the focus is on one of the genders? And I want to bring a perspective which is, you know, it's a fact. And, you know, there's a lot of research that got pointed earlier. And we all know that women are not equally represented at senior levels. You combine that with the human tendency, even very, very deep subconsciously, to pick people who are more like you. It's a catch-22 situation. If we don't have, you know, the spirit of the law, I'm not going into the letter of the law, if we don't have a policy that tries to first acknowledge that problem and then solve that problem, it's a vicious circle, it's a catch-22. Maybe I'll just say another minute if that's okay. Actually, maybe a very personal story about myself on how I relate to that. You know, growing up in India, a lot of, you know, people who would study sciences and maths like me, you know, one of the dreams would be to go to IIT, and I had that dream too. I have no embarrassment in acknowledging that. And I had a rank, let's say, it was 1900 something, and I was very keen to do computer sciences, so they wouldn't pick me for computer sciences. Here is the example I would give on that question, please. There are 1 lakh people who apply to, let's say, 5,000 roles at IIT. You reject 90,000 people, every single one of the 10,000 people are equally capable. I would put myself into that hat if I go back in time. It's not about lowering the bar. It's about breaking that catch-22. You cannot go wrong in that 10,000 people. You make a balanced, better performed, better, better constructed team. And to do that, you have to acknowledge the problem first and then deal with it.
You know, one of the reasons why I started the WILL Forum 12 years ago, when nobody was interested in women at all or didn't know how to spell it, was because I want to escalate the dialogue for women in leadership. And every time I come to a meeting where they're dragging it back to square one, that was there 12 years ago, it is my job to lift it up, which is what I want to do again and again and again. You know, you can't just go on talking about this work-life balance issue. Put out a report. So I put out a report myself. I'm not waiting for McKinsey or somebody to write. I'll write it myself. It's called KPMG, and we wrote the report. It's called Remaining on the Ramp. It's actually a white paper. And on the forward note 4 years ago, we wrote clearly ourselves and KPMG that the question is, are the women leaving the workforce, or is the company driving away the talent of women? Can we have discussions like that? Can we have discussions like that instead of simply focusing on, you know, whether the women can come back? What about the other side of the equation? Are the companies driving away the talent of women? Is that the problem? And therefore the women cannot come back? I mean, you know what I'm saying? You gotta escalate if you want to lean in. If you want to have lean in dialogues, you've got to escalate the dialogue. You cannot be here 10 years later and stand on the same spot.
Okay.
Fantastic. Yeah, we can take a couple of more questions.
Good afternoon, everybody, and good afternoon to all of you. Give a small introduction. I am Captain Shatabdi Chatterjee. I'm the first lady captain from Kolkata. I'm from Civil Aviation. And presently...
Just clap.
And presently, I'm doing my own aviation academy. We do the training and placements for the last 18 years that I have been doing from Cyber City, Gurgaon. Ma'am, to all of you, I have a question. My question is very simple. What is the only one quality a woman should get rid of to get success? Whatever they are doing, business or job, it doesn't matter. And I want to get that opinion from men and women, both of you. I mean, irrespective of gender. That is my question. Thank you.
Maybe I'll just start and, you know, just given the... I don't know if I can just say this is the thing, but this is one of the important things. You know, I touched upon the virus transforming into itself into ambivalence. I think the other way it's trying to transform itself is guilt. I think women feel guilty about spending lesser time with family, and as a result, they cultivate fewer networks, and as a result, that recreates the glass ceiling, and the vicious circle goes on and on and on. The fact that most of the networking today is inauthentic, where most people are just trying to pounce on an opportunity to get some business, doesn't even help. That's the thing I would say. Women should get rid of the guilt and get deliberate about building their networks, again, in their own way, at their own terms and conditions. We touched upon some of the research earlier today. One of the best research in the space from Professor Adam Grant says it's all about give and take, and it starts with giving. So maybe the worthy goal of pursuing around networking is not just to take, but to give. To find role models, LeanIn is doing awesome work. The power of community kicks in into that. At BlackRock, if you don't find a good job at EY and you still want a friendly firm, you could consider BlackRock. You know, the LeanIn circles are being very, very helpful. You know, first find those role models. They exist either in your organization or outside. And then be role models, like helping others. So I would say get rid of that guilt factor.
I'd say self-doubt. If you get rid of that, stop doubting yourself.
Yeah, very true. One last question. Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Ambition.
So.
Oh, get rid of. I'm sorry, I apologize. I was one quality that women should have, I said, get rid of. Well, I think the belief that they can only, you know, that they need to be equal to men, or that they can do anything that men can do. I think just take that out of the equation. Be yourself for what you can do to your potential, and stop measuring yourself against men or anyone else. I think that would be a great mindset.
Yeah, if I saw somebody in front of me, the first thing that I would like them to do is to simply stop making excuses for themselves. It's just so important. If I want a CEO, I want to know, is she hungry? I want hungry women. They got to stop making excuses. You know, all of the excuses will continue for the rest of their lives. As long as the planet is here, Mother Earth is here, we will keep on having issues. Can we park them aside? Can I see some hungry women here who want to reach the top?
Great. One last question from the house.
Yeah, so my question is, I mean, anyone can answer that, but what I've heard from a lot of leaders is that women are being over-mentored, and you know, there's a lot of mentorship happening, but there's no sponsorship. So how would I, as a woman, or maybe even a general employee, reach out to someone like you who's sitting in a glass cabin in a corner office and make myself available and say, hey, I'm open for sponsorship, or how would you notice me? And what are the systems that you would like to have in your office, or maybe you already have one? What are the systems in which, you know, women get noticed and picked up for sponsorship?
We'll start.
I'll go back to what I said around in my personal experience. The number one thing was sponsorship, and within that I said the formal programs. I do think, you know, going back to what Anurag Batra was saying earlier, I do think there will be a time, hopefully in our lifetimes, where we don't need some of these specific project approach to things, but right now we do. So I do think we need sponsorship programs at firms. I sponsor for behalf of BlackRock in APAC, a sponsorship program that has women across all countries in APAC, and we go through a proper program of nomination, self-nomination, manager nomination, pairing up with sponsors, and you know, just going about that. So I think one of the things is that the leaders have to create special programs for that. Hopefully that's not the only thing, and hopefully we won't need that in 5 years from now.
So I just want to make a clarification. I didn't mean women sponsorship programs. I'm saying I am an employee,
yeah,
and I want to be sponsored. I'm looking out for a leader who can sponsor me. What are the ways in which I can make myself noticed, and or is there some, you know, what is that secret sauce that, you know, that's out there, and obviously I don't know about it. So what's that going to be?
You know, this is probably a little domain specific. Might be a little difficult to give a general answer, but I'll still attempt. I would say that most organizations today, at least the progressive organizations, have well-defined processes by which people are heard. I just don't mean the old conventional town hall sessions where you get to hear the top bosses speak, or communication meetings, or the monthly results call, or nothing like that. There are really avenues where, you know, there are platforms where the senior leadership gets to hear employees across the organization. So one way to do that would be to make a determination that you are going to be heard, and that you create within the processes that are available to you a platform by which you specifically state your goal or your ambition or your milestone that you seek to achieve and why you think you're qualified to do that through the conventional processes. The second thing is really, you know, today, 20 years back, you didn't have the kind of platforms we have today to communicate with people. LinkedIn is a great place to, you know, reach out not necessarily to people within your own organization, but across a broader spectrum of leadership that inspires you to reach out and, you know, write a nice communication which is interesting for the person and intriguing, to invite a response that can strike a conversation and carry that forward. I really don't think that there are constraints today to reach out to people that you wish to do so.
Well, I have the mic. Maybe one more minute. Let's do it. I think it's very simple. Want it and ask for it. Let's do a quick experiment in the room. Raise your hand if you asked for sponsorship and you didn't get it. That's the thing. Look around the room. There's probably one person, and we need to solve for that. But the 99% of the problem is asking for it.
So here's, you know, I have 850 mentees, all right, for the past 12 years. They're not free. The company's paying for them, right? We're a will mission. You got to give us money to put it back into the mission. Now, when you have 850 mentees, I'm not there, you know, it's a five-day residential program. I am not telling them what to do. But what strikes me in my head is what I've heard from chairmen and CEOs in the last, I'm on sponsorship, in the last 12 years. So Dr. J.J. Irani, you know, chairman of Tata for a long time, when I went to him, I said, how come you don't, I'm straight with my questions, how come you don't have any women on the Tata board? He said, Poonam, I don't see them. I see you all the time. I don't see the women. They are not visible. He's not seeing them. Now, that's 10 years ago. And so one of the first things we tell all of the mentees on day one is, please get visible from whoever you want a sponsorship from. So let us suppose, I'm giving you a very small token example, that you're right here. When you go back, could you just post yourself on LinkedIn and tag everyone from whom you want a sponsorship? Okay, I'm giving you a small thing to do right now, straight away. Tag everybody. Don't wait. Now, they may see it, okay. They may not see it, okay. But they're all going to see it. When a message comes on LinkedIn, you do. Till today, I still do the same thing. I went to Pune. I don't know many people, you know, and I just wrote to a CEO of Bajaj Allianz, and I said, you know, I need to have a meeting with you, XYZ. Okay, no problem. He invited me to lunch. No problem. I'm just saying, do this when you walk out of the room, but tag the people you want to be visible to. Start from there.
Great. Fabulous set of questions from the House. Thank you, everyone, for your participation. And thank you, distinguished panel, for your valuable advice and insights.
I want to compliment Urvi. I really want to say she's done an outstanding job in briefing the panel. Mm-hmm. You know, it's one of the best briefings I've had as a panelist.
Thank you.
Could you just cheer her up? She's doing a great job.
Thank you. Over to you, Rashmi.